tell you. God is black.
God is black? Everybody knows God is white.
Everything the white man taught you, you accepted. He taught you you were a black heathen and you believed him. He taught you to worship a blonde, blue-eyed Jesus with white skin and you believed him. He taught you that black was a curse and you believed that. Did you ever look up the word black in a dictionary?
For what?
Did you ever study anything that wasn't part of some con?
What the hell for, man?
Come with me.
Welcome, welcome, welcome to our new listeners and to our regular listeners. Welcome to Specificity. Spell it S.P.E.C.I.F.I.C.I.T.Y, where we ask specific questions about specific topics, getting specific answers. The meaning of specificity is the state of being clearly defined or identified, to be precise, exact, or distinguished. All right, and joining me today is Cortlen Combs, an atheist, dissident, which is a person who opposes official policy, especially that of an authoritarian state, I know I butchered that, social contrarian, day trader, and an epistemophile, which is a love of knowledge, specifically striving for or preoccupying with knowledge. Okay, we spoke a little already about this week's topic. Let's get to the questions. When it comes to specificity, this podcast, how would you describe it to someone in two sentences?
I would say speaking about societal issues, societal contentions, topics that may be a bit hard to talk about, but having an open engagement with people about our problems in society and coming to some sort of middle ground. That's how I describe it.
What are some things that you enjoy about it and don't enjoy, that both positive and negative?
I like, of course, the having the conversation in the first place, especially with people you may not agree with up front. I think that's super healthy for all of our society. I think we should talk. The more we talk to people we don't agree with, the more we're going to learn. Because if I just surround myself in an echo chamber of people that agree with me, I'm never going to grow, and I never have a chance to learn anything new. So that's super healthy in and of itself. I think that the best thing, constructive criticism, would be to dig deeper on topics. So when someone gives an answer, ask, it's the specificity podcast, so ask more specific questions about the answers that are given to better understand the overall picture of what we're talking about.
Okay. What are some things that you enjoy from other podcasts that we might be able to incorporate within our own?
Oh, I love hearing from experts. I love hearing from people who have the educational background to back up their opinions. I think finding doctors, finding people who have been in a field, whatever topic you're wanting to talk about, who have been in the field for a really long time and have not only the data but the education and experience that can provide a much better insight to whatever topic is the topic of the week.
Now, what are some things you dislike from other podcasts that we don't practice?
I think that's the main one so far. Okay. On just finding experts. The more experts you find, the more deeply you can engage on in different topics. So I think that would be the biggest one for me still.
Okay. What topics would you like to for us to address in the future?
Hopefully we can touch on it today. But definitely the overall picture of the financial systems in our country, the overall philosophy of, say, capitalism and its effects on society, and compare that to other societies and how they've dealt with different problems, I think that would show shed a huge light on what works and what doesn't, and how other countries have handled things in comparison to America. I think that would be incredibly enlightening to a lot of people.
Now, I mean, you spoke a little bit about this. I sent you an episode number one, What Black People Need from a President, with Joey Pozo.
Yeah.
And you told me you have some comments that you would like to share about the criminal justice system, the effects of slavery going on generationally, the trauma that coincides with it. I mean, what would you like to share? Where would you like to start?
So for start, I do want to start with, like, I'm not going to badmouth Joey. I'm not going to paint a negative light on him. He's not here to defend himself, so I definitely won't be taking any digs that way. But I definitely want to address some of the points, because I feel like it's not fairly represented.
Okay.
To start with, on, you mentioned slavery. There's a good point to be made about generational wealth for Black people versus white people in this country directly related to slavery. So, for hundreds of years, the Black community was enslaved by slave owners and exploited, or their labor was exploited for profit for white families. And Black people got nothing for hundreds of years for their hard work. All of their labor, all the profit of their labor was taken. And so when slavery ended, when they say that, you know, slavery was a long time ago, we need to forget about it. Well, actually, the families who owned slaves and the people who profited from slaves, is it not obvious that those families would have had more generational wealth to pass on to their children, and the slaves had nothing to start with and had nothing to pass on to their children, so their children are growing up poorer than the white families did. And that alone shows that there is a disparity between the white community and the Black community and on generational wealth. Obviously, one is going to be more profitable than the other. And this has been going on for literally ever since slavery ended. It's continued to happen. An example of this is the Tulsa race massacre that happened. And I couldn't believe that we didn't learn this in school. But even in Oklahoma, they don't teach it here. But Tulsa, Oklahoma used to be considered Black Wall Street. That was the highest concentration of Black wealth in the country. And it was literally bombed to the ground. And we're just supposed to pretend like, you know, racism hasn't affected the Black community, that every time that Black families have tried to better themselves and grow wealth and make a fortune for their family to pass on to the generations to follow, they get hindered at every turn.
Now let me ask this. Why do you think is such resistance to essentially Black African American economic and educational independence?
So there's an interesting study. I can find the researcher and send her name to you. She did a TED talk about this, and she went around the country to businesses that were trying to start unions, and she spoke to the employees. And what she found was this disparity between white employees and Black employees, and basically it was how they voted. The Black employees were more likely to vote for the union, because the unions in general are better employees. They help employees have a better workplace experience. And the white employees said to her, well, the Black people are voting for it, so we don't want to do it. If it helps them, then it's not going to help us, so we don't want that. And what she came to at the end of the end of the TED talk, coming to the conclusion that when you offer something like a welfare or a benefit or some sort of socialist benefit to a community, a marginalized community, the poor white end of the spectrum view that as taking from them. Instead of viewing it as, oh, well, a union is going to help all employees, they see it as, oh, well, it's going to help the black employees. That means it's going to take away from me, and I don't want that. And you see that across the board. Over and over, we see that even poor families are against social programs, even when it would help them, because they view benefiting another community is taking away from them, rather than if it benefits another community and brings them up, well, it's also going to bring us up as well.
What I've learned is when it comes to behavior, two things happen. It either stops or it continues and gets worse. So with that mindset, I think they're making that decision instinctually. So it really is not a decision. It's instinctual.
Oh, sure.
Where do you think that comes from? To instinctually think that because it's good for them, it must be bad for me.
Oh, man. I'm sure there's a ton of different ways we can go on this. Historically, I tend to look at the naturalistic explanations for things as far as, like, our behavior. So when I look at how humans have behaved over the course of human history, one of the things we find over and over again is this sense of tribalism. Even amongst...
Now, what is that tribalism? Explain that for the listener.
I let me get an actual, like, definition for you, because I don't want to misrepresent it. Okay, so the definition is the state of or fact of being organized in tribe or tribes. And I would add to this that generally the tribe that you would associate with is a tribe that shares similar interests, similar views, and look similar to you. Mm. And if you look anywhere in the world, all throughout history, even within communities that look the exact same, if a different group of the same people think differently or have different views than them, then you'll see tribalism start to happen even within communities that are basically the exact same. Mm. This would be shown in communities in, what's a good example? Iraq. Iraq would be a good example. Afghanistan would be a good example. These are the same people with the same bloodlines, the same history. They're the same people, but they have different viewpoints. And so based off of those viewpoints alone, they're willing to kill each other over those viewpoints. And that's the same people. And so you take that and put it into context with America, it makes sense that it's so easy for us to just fall into this, oh, I'm a Democrat or I'm a Republican. and that be your whole, like, I'm just going to wholeheartedly follow this side of the party without any question. Like, there's no way that all of America's views and diversity is summed up in two parties. It's just ridiculous. There's no way. Many countries have seen the error in this, and they have multiple parties to accommodate for that, because two parties just aren't enough to encapsulate all of America's viewpoints and diversity. It just isn't the case. And so I tend to lean left, but I find myself so often criticizing both because I see the exact same problem in both.
Even during his conversation, Joey and I, we talked about the independent party and that's most likely the course of action, because whichever party you align yourself with, you have to be a team player.
Right. Oh, exactly. You have to drink the punch and do what that party wants you to do, or you're just not going to succeed. You can't make it in the political parties and in our country unless you drink the juice.
Yeah.
You can't go against the grain and be successful. Bernie Sanders is a perfect example of that. He goes very much so against the grain of both parties, and he was completely railroaded for it. He had no chance in hell of ever getting elected because he's so much different, and he doesn't want to follow in line with what this country is best at, which is putting money in the hands of rich people and exploiting the majority of the American population.
Yeah, you know my intention. We spoke a little bit about this, and the listeners know too. The purpose of this podcast is to address issues which will cause more collateral damage and on a generational level. Instead of sweeping under the rug, we're going to bring it out. We're going to talk about it and formulate ideas, consistent ideas, and that have action tied to them.
Yeah.
In my opinion, where we need to start is we have to go back to slavery itself. Because, and we talked about the difference between bigotry and racism too, and I'll touch on it lightly. A bigot is someone who dislikes another person. It's a personal feeling. It's personal. It's emotion. Racism is a system of power used to benefit or to hinder another group. So, for instance, racism will be a white-only, I said a little feedback on your end, a white-only water fountain. Or it's illegal to read. It's against the law to attain information and knowledge. That is racism.
Yes.
And so what I will, and I think I might have a guest on here too, a psychologist or someone in the mental health field to talk to, it's a little feedback still on your end, to talk to trauma. You know, talk to us about trauma and how trauma works. Because I know there's a certain culture, there had to be a certain culture of racism. What was passed down?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I'm sure it goes far deeper than we can even fathom. And I'm sure they would be able to bring that to light. There is so much stuff, so much research that has been done about trauma specifically and how it relates to race in this country. I mean, I can't imagine the trauma of being afraid for your life every time you see a cop. Like, that's a thing that I don't worry about, and I'm not even white, but I look white, therefore I get to benefit from white privilege. But I've never worried about my life ending at a traffic stop. But I can't tell you how much research there is of black people talking about every time they're pulled over, they're scared that this might be the last day that I'm on this earth. There's definitely trauma. There's PTSD involved there. Yeah. I guarantee you that there are issues with that. And this has been going on for hundreds of years. And of course there's going to be generational trauma that's passed off. Of course.
And I'll elaborate this a little bit more, touch on it. Help me out with this. If you unmute, and then while I talk, if you'll mute, let's see if that helps that feedback.
Sure.
Okay. And I think it ties into relationships as well, where you demasculate the male in front of the whole family. He's no longer a protector. He's no longer a man on a fundamental level. I think that ties into the dynamic of the relationship we see now. Another thing is the reading and writing. It made the culture of reading and writing, one, dangerous, and two, now it's frowned upon. Because if you do that, you know the consequences. So I think that's one thing, is the attainment of information. Another thing is to think for ourselves, and to ownership, black ownership. And this is my opinion, and what I've read on, it wasn't common, and it wasn't during that time to own anything, because what other life is there? Of course, we transitioned out of it, and like what you mentioned with the Black Wall Street, and then the violence starts again. And so what I would like to have a mental health, someone, a therapist or counselor, someone to walk me through, one, the traumas that existed in that time period, and how trauma works when it comes to finally getting yourself out, head is above water, and then the massacres come. So what, in the mind, and what do you teach your children? Because they watch more than they listen. They're observing with their eyes. What type of things, action-wise, were passed down, and how does that affect their children's children? And so I think that's a dynamic that we don't speak about nearly enough and gets brushed under the rug, is how, from a traumatic, from a mental health and emotional standpoint, how have we, and maybe we haven't, maybe this is still some of the effects of the dysfunctional relationships, of the lack of pride and ownership and independence as a community. I was driving through the Paseo, and I saw a small Chinatown. I don't think I've ever seen a small Africa, a small Black America. I've never even heard the idea. So where do we need to go? What do we need to do? And this is a question for my listeners to have on their own too, and as well as for myself. Where do we need to start in order to truly begin healing and then pass that healing on to our kids who will pass that on to theirs?
I think you touched on a lot of good stuff there. I think that'd be super helpful to learn more about that topic. And speaking from my own experience, growing up, I didn't think that I had any trauma. Throughout my life, you know, I looked at other people's life, and if their life was worse, I was like, oh, well, they had it worse, so I'm fine. Mine wasn't that bad. And it wasn't until I got into a comfortable financial position in my life to where I was able to, you know, instead of having to work 2-3 jobs just to make ends meet, I was able to just kind of relax and start self-reflecting. And if your life is always a struggle just to survive, just to get, just how do I keep the lights on this month? How do I pay the rent this month? You're always going to be trapped in this perpetual cycle of never dealing with your trauma. And it wasn't until I got comfortable and I actually started going to therapy. And I would suggest therapy to everybody. Why? Going to therapy doesn't mean that you're messed up. We all have our traumas. You may not think you do, but I promise you, you do. Everyone does. And it would be so healthy for everyone to go to therapy and to learn about these things. But I wasn't able to until I got comfortable. And I think that right there is why so much of our country, specifically the Black community, is unable to start dealing with that trauma. Because of the inequality of wealth, specifically with the Black community. If you look at all across our nation, you look at the poorest areas in the country, regardless of city, what you're going to find is generally Black communities are the poorer areas. And it's that way for a reason. There is systematic oppression that has happened over the course of generations to make those communities poorer and have less of an opportunity to grow. Why? There's less job opportunities. There's less. You mentioned it in the last podcast about lack of skills. And this is a lack of skills across the board. There aren't very many skill courses that you can take in school. There are a few places. Like I know we had vocab. Is it vocab?
Votech.
Did I get that right? Is that the name of it?
Votech.
Votech. That's it. Yes, we had Votech, and that program is, you know, in place in other places across our country, but it's nowhere near as prevalent as it should be. Because the money just doesn't go there. And another thing that I've learned about school funding specifically, school funding in our country, for the most part, comes from property taxes. So on the poor side of town, which just so happens to be Black, the property taxes are lower over there because the property's cheaper. Therefore, the schools get less funding. Therefore, the schools get less teachers, and they get less teachers, and the classrooms are more full, so the workload for teachers is even higher, which means the education that the students are getting is going to be subpar to what it would be in a wealthy neighborhood that just so happens to be predominantly white. I think that right there is going to be a big portion until we are able to stop the inequality of wealth in this country. We're not going to be able to deal with those generational traumas. We're not even going to make any headway, because if you're constantly struggling just to get by, just to pay your bills, you don't have time for anything else other than that specifically. And it's not just the Black community that suffers from this. It's the entire country. And this is why when I mentioned earlier about, you know, white people not wanting anything that benefits Black people, even to their own detriment.
Wow.
They don't realize that helping the Black community is going to help them as well, because if the floor rises, the floor rises for everybody, not just the Black community. If we start fixing these systematic problems in our society about how wealth is distributed, we're gonna have a better solution. You know, so often I hear, oh, we can't just give money away for free. We can't just give people free money. That's not gonna fix anything. People are gonna be lazy. Well, that's actually not true. There's a study done in Canada with this city called Daffing. I probably pronounced that wrong, but it's spelled Daffing. But what they did is they experimented with universal basic income in this city and gave everybody in the city a minimum amount of money, enough money to pay their bills, enough money to pay their rent and food. Okay, and it's not enough to live in a mansion. It's not enough to live a life of luxury. It is just your necessities. And what they found is that not only did poverty end immediately, but crime rates went down, education rose, and health got better. Because at this point now, they didn't have to worry about, oh, am I going to be able to pay rent this month? Am I going to be homeless at the end of this month? They don't have to worry about that anymore. So they don't have to work 2-3 jobs just to make ends meet anymore. Mm-hmm. Their needs are already met. And so, and what they found is people didn't get lazy. They actually worked harder because now that their necessities were taken care of, now they could start working on, oh, well, how do I save money for my children's education? And so they started working to save money so that their kids could have a better education, so that the generations past them would have a better life than they did. So people actually worked harder. And giving more resources to a community is literally the solution. And I want to talk a little bit about the minimum wage and how much of an impact it could have on our society. We get drink water fast.
Of course.
Okay, so to put things in perspective, I'm going to go to America in 1960s and early 70s. Let me get my information here. Okay. In 1963, the minimum wage, or let me start with the value of a dollar in 1963. Because of inflation, which we all know our money has deflated over time, just in our lifetime, things have gotten drastically more expensive. And the reason for this is because of inflation. So $1,000 in the 1960s is worth the equivalent in buying power today of about $120 to $150. The minimum wage back in 1969 was $1.60 an hour, which equates to about a little over $9 for us now. So our $9 an hour, which by the way isn't even minimum wage. Minimum wage now is $7.25. So their $1 an hour, well, $1.60 an hour, but that's actually even more. But just a dollar back then was more than our current minimum wage is now. And now here's the part that really puts it in perspective. In the 60s, you could work a minimum wage job and graduate from Harvard or Yale debt-free. So the cost to go to Harvard in 1970 was about $1,800. And the cost of Yale was about $2,500 in the early 70s, 1970s. Oh, and that $1,800 for Harvard was 1964. So you working a full-time job at $1.60 an hour gets you $3,000 a year approximately. So not only were you paying off your debt to go to one of the most prestigious schools in the entire country, but you came out of school not only debt-free, but you made profit. You were in the green. You had savings after graduating from one of the most prestigious schools in the country. Now, to relate that to how it is now, you could work 3 full-time minimum wage jobs at 120 hours a week, which, by the way, leaves zero time to spend with your family, your friends, to give you zero time for any self-care, enough sleep, none of that. You would be barely sleeping, barely eating, and just working your ass off 120 hours a week, and you still couldn't pay off your Harvard education. You still couldn't do it. So to the people that say that, you know, our generation is lazy and that, you know, we just want things handed to us. No, we just want a fair chance to have what they had. We don't even have a fair chance of getting what they had then. They were able to work a part-time or a minimum wage job and come out of school debt-free. Oh, and by the way, back then, one household income was enough to take care of a family. And nowadays, I don't know any family that's surviving on just one income. It needs to be 2 incomes to survive, minimum, because things are so expensive now. if you go to college now, you can't come out debt-free unless you have a ton of scholarships. Then you can. But we just want a fair chance to accomplish what they did then. And the data clearly shows that we don't have that ability. We have to work three times as hard just to get a fraction of what they had, and we don't even get it. We will still come out of college working three full-time minimum wage jobs. We will still come out of college in debt, and we still won't have any in savings. And they wonder why our generation struggles. They wonder why people, the poverty level in this country is so high. This is why, because we don't have a fair chance to accomplish what they did, even though we're working three times as hard. And productivity is at an all-time high, even though wages have stayed stagnant. If minimum wage had matched just the cost of inflation, the minimum wage should be minimum over $22 an hour. Just for starters, we're not even mentioning how much the cost of living has gone up as a result, and to compensate for that. But the reason everything has gotten more expensive is because of inflation. And so we're fighting a unwinnable fight, and the solution truly is more resources. And anyone who says more money for our fellow Americans isn't going to help them is crazy to me. It's crazy to think that, okay, more resources fixes these problems, as shown in Daphne, Canada. More resources not only lowered crime rates, but ended poverty altogether. And by the way, the cost of that universal basic income was nowhere near as expensive as people think. And but I'm not even saying that we do a universal basic income. If we just paid people what they're worth, that would be enough. And you're going to get the people who say, like, oh, well, the burger flipper doesn't deserve to make $15 an hour. First of all, I don't care if you're Republican or Democrat, conservative or liberal. I believe if you work an honest 40 hours a week, you deserve to feed your family. I do not believe you deserve to starve because you flip burgers. And to say that the burger flipper doesn't deserve to feed their family, I think is having a lack of empathy for your fellow human being, your fellow American that you should care about. We are stronger when we're together. And if you notice, in our country, it's left versus right. It's divide and conquer, because if we are just fighting each other, we're not going to look at the bigger issue, which is the fact that our money doesn't go anywhere near as far as it does, or as far as it should, and that no one makes as much as they deserve. And to say that the burger flipper doesn't deserve as much as the EMT worker who makes $15 an hour, well, of course the EMT deserves to make more. If the minimum wage should be $22, the EMT deserves a whole lot more than that. The problem is no one is getting paid what they deserve in this country. And the labor shortage we have in this country, it's not because people are lazy. It's because people are tired of working for poverty wages. They're tired of working 2-3 jobs and still not being able to make ends meet. That's not fair to anybody, both on the Democratic side and the Republican side. All of our fellow Americans deserve to make an honest living for honest work. And no one should deserve to starve working 40 hours a week. It's just despicable. And to say that the wealthy, and let me show the, I sent you a video a few days ago about the wealth inequality in this country. To put it into perspective, 90% of Americans share between the poorest of the poor and the upper middle class, we all share 7% of all wealth in America. Just 7%. And the top 9% have 100 times more than that. And then the top 1% of the top 9% or of the top 10% have 40% of all wealth in America. Now, I'm down for living the American dream and starting a small business and making money and passing on generational wealth. But there's no way that anyone can justify to me how 10% of the population deserves 93% of all of America's wealth. If you ask Americans, there's a poll done about this. They asked Americans, and this is across the board, Republican and Democrat, how do you think wealth should be distributed in our country? And they all said it should be a gradual uptrend from the poorest of the poor to the richest of the rich. And if this were the case, then the harder you work, the more money you make, the higher up in society you move.
That seems pretty fair. And that was agreed upon by all sides, left and right. They said, ideally, that's how it should be. And they asked them, how do you think the money is actually distributed? And they said it's, well, it, a little more skewed. They thought that the top 20% had a lot more wealth, but there was still a fair amount of wealth distributed around America. But it's just not the case. As I said earlier, 93% of all wealth is held by the top 10% of Americans. And the rest of us have to share 7%. And what makes this even worse is that our fellow Americans, whether you're a coal mine worker, whether you worked at Tractor Supply, whether you are a farmer, everyone, 90% of all Americans are paying 30%+ in taxes, while the wealthiest of the country who make billions of net profit, not gross profit, net profit, billions.
What's the difference between net and gross profit?
So net is, or gross profit is total income brought in by a business, and the net profit is going to be after expenses. So if you build chairs, the amount of money it costs you to pay your workers, the amount of money it costs you to pay for wood, nails, glue, stain, all the expenses that go into your business, you subtract that from the gross profit, and what's left is your net profit. So after doing all the subtracting, net profit, these companies are bringing in billions of dollars a quarter, and they can't pay their employees more. They can't pay them more than minimum wage, which, by the way, isn't minimum wage. When minimum wage was first enacted, it was supposed to be a minimum amount to survive in this country. But now, on minimum wage, there is nowhere in this country that you can pay your bills on minimum wage. Nowhere. Nowhere in this country. It is not possible to be able to have enough money to pay for all the things that you need as a basic human needs on minimum wage. It's not doable. And these companies are making billions a quarter and not able to pay their employees more? I mean, it's ridiculous. And this idea that trickle-down economics works is nonsense. Einstein said it best. You can't solve today's problems with the same mentality that created them. So our current situation in America, our current line of thinking says that this is enough, this is good enough for our people. Yet our people are struggling, yet we have a high homeless rate in our country. Crime is still a problem all across our country. And what's the common denominator here? That our money, there's not enough resources going to the people. And as seen in Daphne, Canada, that is the solution. If we just pay people enough money to make an honest living, they're not going to turn to crime. Because here's another thing that's important to note about crime rates. Regardless of where you look in the world, where you find poverty, you find crime. Every single time. If you are unable to feed your family working an honest job, you're going to turn to crime. It happens every single time. You're going to, no matter who you are, no matter what race you are going to do whatever you have to do to feed your family. And if that means selling drugs on the corner, you're going to do it because that's what you have to do to feed your family.
And this is the intention that I'm learning. I think that it's a profitable business for failure. I think failure is a profitable business. Underachieving, yes, and to the detriment of others, I, yes, think is a profitable business. Someone has to work these jobs that are really low paying, and it's not going to be me. So how about this? How about we'll start from the top? We'll make education subpar. So we create workers that just know how to get up and do a 8 to 4, a 7 to 3, 7 to 5.
Yep.
We won't bring vocational schools in, or we will, except there's going to be a small amount of people that can get through. Those who don't make it, hey, good luck. So we'll take, yeah, a small sect of these people, and these might be our potential business or small business owners, our tradesmen, maybe future professors for the very vocational school that's taking them. So, okay, so we got them to decide. Everybody else, we need you all to not be successful. We don't need, yep, you to infiltrate the quote-unquote elite. We need you to be regular workers, work regular jobs, commit crimes, and die. Because it's profitable as business. From food stamps to Section 8, and this is no knocks or aspersions against these things. This is what it is. To these government assistances, it's a business. Somebody has to work at the office. Somebody has to issue. Somebody has to print the paperwork. Somebody has to buy the paper, the ink for the printer, for these things to happen. A Google or email server, tech. Somebody has to pay for these things, and they're paying for them to your detriment. So the money that, and this I'm speaking to us as a whole, the money that we're not getting by underachieving and having a lack of discipline and goals and planning, the money that we're not getting by doing that, they're giving to other people to essentially who are aimed at holding us back, which are not all policemen. The intention of, yet remember, police started from watching ownership and property. That was the whole intent of, you know, policemen. And it's gradually evolved into this, into what it is now. The intent is honestly to make employees. Somebody has to be a prisoner. It's a great business. Prison is a legacy criminal is a great business. That's generational wealth for somebody else. Because odds are your son or daughter, for the parent that's not in their lives, they're going to most likely, on average, be in a dysfunctional relationship or be in and out of the correction system themselves. So we have to understand these things, that it's by design. So get a piece of paper out, get a pen, write a plan, you know, stick to it. Be disciplined with our money. McDonald's is fine. You don't need McDonald's to eat. You know, you want to go to the store. You know, we have finances. It's what we want to do. Cut off the Netflix, cut off the YouTube subscription, get a cheaper phone. If that's taking up where your budget is, it's time to start looking at our budget. What is a necessity and what is luxury? I was told if you're not able to buy two of them, you're really not able to afford one. So what, and I'm doing this in my life too, it's time to get down to the fundamentals. What is important and the things that aren't important, it's time to either trim them or sever it and take that same money I was given every month for these bills of luxuries that I don't need and put them into ourselves, into getting a trade or LLC or a license or vocational school, learning how to be an electrician or a plumber or it's a mechanic. It's time to have consistent actions. And if we don't, then we're going to be where we've always been, doing the things we've always done. And the same things you were doing 5 years ago, you're going to do in the next 5 years. And your kids are going to inherit that unless they're an anomaly. They're going to follow the same patterns because they're watching you. And they're going to emulate what you're doing because you're doing it. It must be right. So it's time to just do better. Corbin, do something for me. In closing, what do you want the listeners and potential supporters to come away with this episode? What are your final words for the people?
Real quick, if you don't mind, I wanted to touch on what you just said.
Of course.
So I actually think the cards are actually stacked against anyone. If you could have the best plan, you could have the best work ethic, and you could strive for a greater you and a greater generations, you know, after you. But the cards are stacked against you because of the wealth inequality. And to add to this, I should have mentioned it earlier, but someone at the SEC released recently, they leaked documents from some of the richest people in America.
What is the SEC? Elon Musk. What does that represent? What is the SEC?
It's the Securities Exchange Commission.
Thank you.
And it basically deals with things like the stock market, things like investments, and they're supposed to be the regulators that help keep the markets fair. Hmm. But when when those documents got leaked, it showed the tax returns of and I may have misquoted. That may have been an IRS leak. Might actually rephrase IRS leak. It showed that between Elon Musk, Warren Buffett, Jeff Bezos, the average taxes they paid was 3%. While our fellow Americans, you and me and everybody else, pays over 30%. And so, again, these people who are making billions per quarter are only paying 3% on their taxes. they don't have to pay the fair amount that we have. And so when people ask, where's the money going to come from to help our society? Well, the first thing we should do is tax the wealthiest people in this country. Tax the wealthy so that the poor have a chance to make it. Because if the money taken from just them paying their fair share of taxes, I'm not even talking about, you know, breaking their door down and taking their money. I'm saying just make them pay a fair amount that the rest of our Americans are. That would be enough money to fund all the programs we need, whether it be universal health care, even if we wanted to try universal basic income, which I'm not necessarily advocating for, but even though the studies show that it would work, this is what needs the overall problem. I want to zoom out with problems in our country. The further you zoom out, the more you see the overall problem here. And I think it's less of people buying iPhones that's keeping them poor, and less of them having Netflix that's keeping them poor. And I think it's much more that there's just not enough money to go around, and that the wealthiest of our country are hoarding all the wealth like dragons on top of gold. If we could just get them to pay their fair share, then and put more money into the economy for all Americans, things would be better for everybody. And then the same thing goes with how America spends its money so irresponsibly across the board. We have more military spending than the top 10 countries combined. And I don't know about you, but I don't want any of my fellow Americans going to war for anything. Obviously, I understand the need for a military, but the need to spend 10 times more than the next 10 countries combined is ridiculous. If we took a fraction of that and put it into the American economy, we could have universal health care, which, by the way, we're the only first world country to not have universal health care, and we are the wealthiest country in the history of the human species. And yet somehow it's bad for our country. I dare anyone to talk to a Canadian and say that their universal health care sucks, or talk to someone from Norway and say that their universal health care sucks. They will laugh in your face. It doesn't suck, and every American, Republican and Democrat, deserves health care. Everyone does. And we can still have insurance and private sector if we wanted. But we should have that. And so to close, I would say for sure the overall problem in our country, at least in matters of poverty and the systematic problems that affects people who are poor, it is because there is not enough money in the economy for you to have a chance. Most people think that they're just a temporarily poor millionaire, and that one day they'll get to be part of the top 10%. But statistics show that's just not the case. Statistically, the cards are stacked against you, especially if you're black in this country. Because if you're black, there's a study done about just names. If you on job applications with the same experience, the same hit work history,
yeah.
If you put a generic black name and a generic white name, the white names got 50% more callbacks. So already, if you're in the black community and you're like, I'm gonna work hard, I'm gonna get several jobs. Well, the cards are already stacked against you because you're gonna get 50% less callbacks than someone who's white based solely off of your name and not even the color of your skin. But then once we get to the color of the skin, it gets even worse because studies have shown that regularly across the board, across sectors, across industry, black employees make less than their white counterparts, even if the black employees have more experience. And there again is another example of blatant systemic racism in our country that oppresses the minorities of our country. And this isn't even to get into the statistics that show how much harder it is to be black in regards to police brutality and incarceration rates. Because if you're black, the rate at which you get convicted and the length of time you stay in prison is much longer than someone who's white for the exact same crime. You're 25% more likely to go to jail for drugs, even though white and black people use drugs at about the same rate. And I think there's much more we could delve into on matters of racism, and I'm totally down to talk about that more if you want to do that sometime. But I think the main thing I want to get across is that the true problem in our society is not your fellow Americans. It's not the people on the right. It's not the people on the left. We need to join together to look at the real problem, which is the fact that 10% of the population hoards 93% of all wealth, and we all are supposed to fight for the scraps. And if history is a lesson about any of this, that is a recipe for disaster. Rome fell for that exact same reason. France went into revolution and collapsed over this same reason. When the wealthy of the country hoard everything and exploit the workers, it's a banana republic, and that is exactly what America is. And if we want to start fixing the problems that we face in this nation, the first thing we need to do is topple this banana republic we have and make things more fair and make everyone across the board pay the fair amount of taxes so that we can have a fair chance at making it and a fair chance at living the American dream for all Americans.
Hmm. Let me see, what do I want to end with? You know, Corbin, thank you for coming on the show.
Hey, dude, thanks so much for having me, man. It was an absolute pleasure. I love what you're doing, and please keep doing it. And anytime you'd like to have me, I'd love to be on here.
Oh, I know how I'm going to end it. And I'm going to speak selfishly to my black community first, and then to other communities second. One thing we have to keep in mind, the black dollar circulates maybe twice and then leaves the community. I'm gonna say it again. Our dollar, when we get it, maybe circulates twice and then leaves. Now the question is, what are we gonna do about it on a consistent basis? The money's gonna come. As Cortlen stated, we know what needs to be done. So when it comes, is it gonna leave right back immediately? Or is it gonna circulate more? And with that, we thank you for joining us on Specificity.